The fulcrum of development of modern medicine rests on this inflammation. We shall get new drugs not only to fight cardiovascular diseases, but also to fight diabetes in the next 10 years, and all those perhaps shall only be on inflammation. Now, while speaking on cardiovascular disorders, we all know CVD is the leading cause of death globally, accounts for 31% mortality. In India, it accounts for 28% mortality. 12 to 16% of CVD patients are young. And it will be stunned to know that in almost 60% of the patients, there is only one risk factor before a person suffers from an MI. The CVD risks are, of course, diabetes is a CVD risk equivalent, lipids, hypertension, hemostatic or thrombotic disorders, behavioral factors, demographic changes, and obviously the genetic predisposition. Risk factors, as I have been telling you, this pie shows that more than 60% of the cases have only one or even none of the traditional risk factors, and more than half have either normal or mildly increased lipid values. hsCRP, as you all know, is the perhaps the only marker of inflammation for heart cardiovascular diseases. It is well studied now. I am rushing through the slides a bit because there are too many slides, I feel. The Center for Disease Control and Prevention had first laid stress on hsCRP in 2003 when they said that it may help direct further evaluation and therapy in the primary prevention of CVD. The entire adult population should not be screened for hsCRP, they have said, for purposes of cardiovascular risk assessment. But in 2010, they had gone a step further and they say that measure CRP in apparently healthy elderly people to identify cardiovascular risk. Initially, they had stated that you need not screen everybody. Now they say measure CRP in also apparently healthy elderly people to identify cardiovascular risk. And see what they say in 2013. They say use of hsCRP for stratifying the high risk patients for atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. And this comes in the ACC/AHA guideline on the treatment of blood cholesterol to reduce atherosclerotic cardiovascular risk in adults. Now the atherosclerosis, the pathogenesis, most of you freshen up. The endothelium leaks, the monocytes leak the endothelium, followed by LDL. The LDL gets oxidized, and this oxidized LDL then leads to the inflammation. One, it acts on the macrophage through the nuclear factor kappa B along with TPR gamma. And this oxidized LDL with macrophage turns into foam cells. The oxidized LDL also acts through the dendritic cell. The dendritic cell is bound in the kininogen pathway, while the other foam cells and the macrophages are involved in the nuclear factor KB pathway. The mediators, the main inputs IL-1, IL-6, TNF-alpha, which again lead to production of ICAM-1, BCAM-1, which are the addition molecules. And defense against these cytokines is mainly through 3-HAA. That is 3-hydroxyanthranilic acid through the kininogen and NFKB pathway. Now, where do we target? Till date, we have only one target, that's the statin, which acts on the endothelium. Newer targets would involve both the NFKB pathway and the kininogen pathway. HAA acts through the kininogen pathway and helps to block it. We also have the NFKB inhibitor curcumin, which acts on the NF, and blocks the NFKB. Now coming to the NFKB. NFKB is usually is first found in the cytoplasm, we all know. Then it is translocated to the nucleus. There is an inflammatory stimuli. There is activation of IKKB through the IKKB kinase. There is activation of NFKB. It migrates to the nucleus, and then there is release of inflammatory mediators. The pro-inflammatory cytokines are released, namely TNF-alpha, interleukin-6, interleukin-1-beta, and high-sensitive CRP. Also, there is release of adhesion molecules, intracellular adhesion molecule 1 and vascular cell adhesion molecule 1. Now, coming to the mechanism of action of curcumin, it prevents, as I told earlier, it prevents activation of NFKB, which also prevents translocation into the nucleus, prevents release of inflammatory mediators. So we don't have those cytokines, we don't have those adhesion molecules, and the inflammation is checked. So in summary, the anti-inflammatory role in CBD of curcumin, it decreases the CRP and the malonyl-CoA, decreased MI associated with CABG. It leads to significant reduction in the serum cholesterol levels and prevents progression of diabetic nephropathy by attenuating proteinuria, TGF-beta, IL-8 in type 2 DM nephropathy. There is also decrease in fasting blood glucose, HbA1c and insulin resistance index. For the past 2 years, we are getting international papers on diabetes, which shows that diabetes is also an inflammatory disease. And perhaps in the years to come, we shall more focus on the inflammatory markers in diabetes as well. The visceral adiposity had been our stress point initially. Now we find it's not the visceral adiposity that is directly responsible, rather the macrophages which lie in between those adipocytes which are responsible for all the pathology and the pathogenesis of diabetes. And here this play a role. And recently, the hydroxychloroquine has been approved as a drug for diabetes as an anti-inflammatory medicine. Now coming to the other pathway, the kinin-renin pathway. It all starts from tryptophan, from which we get the kinin-renin, then the anthranic acid and the 3-hydroxyanthranin, then 3-HAA. And this 3-HAA block leads to reduced atherosclerosis, there is anti-atherosclerotic effect, and there is reduction in LDL through HHA, which blocks conversion to quinolinic acid and the nicotinamide. 3-HAA is an intermediate, 3-hydroxyanthranilic acid is an intermittent metabolite for tryptophan when metabolized to the kinin-renin pathway. In macrophages, leads to activation of nuclear factor kappa B, activity of inducible nitric oxide synthase and interleukin-2, interleukin-7 and interleukin-15 stimulation. The 3-hydroxyanthranilic acid reduces the uptake of oxy-LDL by the macrophages and prevents formation of foam cell. This is a pictorial effect of 3-HAA effect on lipid metabolism related genes. And all these leads to reduction in the plasma cholesterol and the reduction in triglycerides. You'll find 3-HAA reduces both components of the entire lipid profile, that is the triglyceride component and the cholesterol component. It decreases plasma lipids by 1/3 to 2/3 levels. 3-HAA effect on inflammation, it reduces the infiltration of CD4, that's the helper T cells in atherosclerotic lesions also. It significantly reduces inflammation, there is 80% reduction in atherosclerotic lesions. So in summary, 3-HAA is an intermediate metabolite of kinin-renin pathway, that is the tryptophan metabolism. It has the following clinically significant benefits. It improves the lipid profile by decreasing VLDL and LDL levels and increasing HDL levels. 3-HAA significantly reduces vascular inflammation. Now, coming to some other targets which are also under consideration, and they are in different phases of trials. Some are in phase 3 trials, some are in phase 2 trials. I am giving a brief overview of these. The SPLA2 is a phospholipase inhibitor. It leads to lipoprotein modification and release of bioactive lipids. It's in phase 3 trials. The succinylbucol is an antioxidant. The mechanism of action is not specified, but it's in phase 3 trials. The lipoprotein PLA2 phospholipase A2 inhibitor, it leads to lipoprotein modification and release of bioactive lipids, is in phase 3 trials. And the FLAP, which targets the leukotriene pathway, inhibits leukotrienes, reduces leukocytes activity in flux, and it's in phase 2 trials. 5 alone targets the leukotriene pathway, inhibits leukotrienes, reduces leukocyte activity in flux. The CCR2 pathway is also involved. There is inhibition of the monocyte trafficking into exosomatic path. It's under phase 3 trials. TNF, in the TNF pathway, TNF mediated effects we all know. It's in the very initial stages of development. Interleukin-1, target pathway is interleukin-1 pathway. The interleukin-1 mediated effects are stopped. It's in phase 2 trial. And P-selectin prevents cellular migration of endothelial cells and blocks the monocytes, leukocytes penetration into internal space. It's in phase 2 trials. So in conclusion, despite optimum therapy with current drugs, still one-third of low-risk individuals with 0 or 1 FRS Framingham score risk factor have been known to develop atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. Controlling inflammation will help improve cardiovascular outcomes and may also further help reduce morbidity and mortality in patients with CVD. Thank you all. Thank you all for taking me.